And good morning, EC. Why don't you stand with us as we worship the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the God of the promise this morning. Not gonna wait for the walls to fall, 'cause I know a name that will bring them down. And I've got a praise waking within my soul, and I'm not ashamed to declare it now. Light of the world, light of the world, you trample the darkness. Nothing can stop it. You are the God of the promise. Every word will be accomplished. Nothing can stop it. You are the God of the promise. Prepare the way, the King of Glory comes. Before his name, every fear must bow. Throw off your chains. Jesus destroyed them all. And up from the grave, he is with us now. Light of the world, you trample the darkness. Nothing can stop it. You are the God of the promise. Every word will be accomplished. Nothing can stop it. You are the God of the promise. The gates of hell will never stand a chance. Your name prevails. Jesus, the great I am. No word will fail. No weapon formed against your name prevails. Jesus, the great I am. The gates of hell will never stand a chance. Your name prevails. Jesus, the great I am. No word will fail. No weapon formed against your name prevails. Jesus, the great I am. Let's sing it out. Light of the world, light of the world, you trample the darkness. Nothing can stop it. You are the God of the promise. Every word will be accomplished. Nothing can stop it. You are the God of the promise. Come on, praise him this morning. He is worthy to be praised.
If you're troubled, heavy hearted, come to Jesus and find your peace. If you're run down, empty handed, come to Jesus and find your strength. He is hope for the hopeless, rest for the weary, help for the hurting. He is, he is. conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe. For the souls of all who come to the Father are restored, and the Church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not fade. By His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Praise forever to you, God. We thank you this morning. You are worth it, and you are holy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Guys, go ahead and have a seat for a moment. I ask you to go ahead and get your communion elements ready. I want to take us to Galatians 2, verse 20. It says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if righteousness or through the law, then Christ died for no purpose. And we believe that Christ died for a purpose. And is the reason that we partake in the elements of the bread and the juice representing his body and his blood for us. And that what we could not do, fulfilling the law and trying to work on our own, we could never do it, he said, don't worry, I have it. I've got it. And it is not I, but Christ in me. Here in a moment, we're going to sing a new song. And last year, I had the first time I actually played and sang this song with some friends. And when I think back to the words of this song called Same God, it reminds me that the same God who chose this, the same God who Paul wrote to the Galatians, that same God is speaking now. And he's here now. And in a second, I'm going to read from a book that I love. It's a book of prayers. And I'm asking you, as I read this book, would you take the elements when the Spirit leads you to do that? And if you begin to sing this new song with us, you can sit there, you can stand, you can take whatever posture of worship you want to. I'm asking you to remember that the same God back then is the same God today. So we are gathered here uniquely in all of history. We particular people in this singular time and place, accomplish your purposes among us, O God. Tune our hearts to the voice of your Spirit. Wake us to be present to you and to another in these shared hours we are given. For it is you, O Lord, who have so gathered us from our various places, and you alone who know our hearts and our needs. Among us are some who arrive anxious, who are lonely, who suffer pain and sorrow. And those of us in our joys, may you grant us grace to enter in the sorrow of others. Among us, some who are arriving are rejoicing, hearts made light by good news and good health. May those of us in our sorrows find grace to embrace the joys of others. Lord, let us prize these moments and care for one another deeply. Breathe upon this moment, this gathering, O Spirit of God. Grant each of us a place to humbly receive and faithfully serve, that we might know in this brief gathering a foretaste of that greater communion yet to come. O Father, enlarge our hearts. O Spirit, expand our vision. O Christ, establish your kingdom among us. Be at work even now, O Lord. May your will be accomplished in us. I'm adding an ease for you in these hours. Oh God, let your kingdom be established and be accomplished. Amen.
I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures to generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same thing for me. For me, for me. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness, on your faithfulness. I'm calling on the God of Mary, whose favor rests upon the lowly. I know with you all things are possible. I'm calling on the God of David, who made a shepherd boy courageous.
I believe this.
I may not face Goliath, but I've got my own giants. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness, on your faithfulness. Standing on your faithfulness.
You hurt your children then. You hear your children now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing then. You are the same God. You are the same God. You moved in power then. God moved in power now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were a healer then. You are a healer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were a savior then. You are a savior now. You are the same God. You are the same God. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh, rock, oh, rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. Oh, on your faithfulness. Oh, God, my God, I need you. Oh, God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh, rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness, on your faithfulness. Come on, praise Him. Amen. It is always just a great reminder for us that we never clap for a song, we never clap for people, we clap because He is great. And He is worthy. And with that, we're excited as a last-minute baptism was added like 10 minutes ago. So just sit down and draw your attention over here. We're excited to celebrate this.
Hello, my name's Leanne Gerritsen, and I'm baptizing my daughter, Chloe Castillo, today. I've been praying for this for so long, so don't ever give up on praying for your children. And thank you to my small group that's here today. Chloe, do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God?
Yes.
Do you accept Him as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Upon your confession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
I'll preach after that all day long, all day. good morning, everyone. Happy spring break to, I know, a lot of our families. So I'm assuming a lot are maybe watching online, hopefully somewhere south and warm, because this past week of Illinois weather was the worst. But have hope, everyone. I did see 60-degree weather is coming, okay? So have faith, have hope. My name is Zach Thompson, and I have the privilege of being the high school pastor here at Eastview. And before we get rolling with this morning, some of you may or may not know my story, but I'm a born and raised Eastview kid. For almost my entire life, I've called Eastview home. I was raised up through what was called Kids View at the time, and then we just switched the two to Eastview Kids now. I then transitioned and I went through what was called our preteen ministry, was called Blast. If you were here that long ago, it was called Blast, and then The Edge in junior high. And then high school just never could stay with one name. It was Oasis, it was One, it was SHM, it was all these things. Which, by the way, like 2000s language, Blast, Edge, Oasis, like that was like the names of ministries. But I grew up here, and I share that partly because it sets the context of why this season of the church has been one of the most difficult for me. I've felt all of the emotions, and it's weighed very heavy on me. But it's one that's reminded me of the things I learned when I was a kid in Kids View, when I was a junior higher in The Edge, when I was a high schooler in Oasis 1, SHM, all the names. I am a product of the people in my life that have shown me my trust, my hope, my joy, my peace, my life is in Jesus. My hope's not in a building. It's not in a person. It's not in a ministry. My hope's in Jesus. And so it's why I'm itching to be up here on this stage with you, because I've found that when you fix your eyes on the majesty and the person of Jesus, you can have hope in the midst of any storm. And the heat and the drought, they might come, but those who trust in the Lord will continue to bear the fruit of God's good and saving work. And that's the word I have for you guys this morning. So if you would open your Bibles to Jeremiah chapter 17, that's where we're going to be spending most of our time today. And here's the crazy thing about God, and I found over and over that God tends to speak through his word the most timely messages, whether that's in my own personal study or whether that's in a sermon I'm preparing for you today. And as I was studying this week, I found myself being in awe of how much I needed to preach this passage to myself. And I pray that this is a word that it's something that we all need to hear today. For those of us that are here or watching online that are going through a season of really feeling the heat, feeling the pressure of life. For those in the room or watching online that are in a season of drought, maybe relationally, maybe physically, maybe spiritually, those in the room or watching online who have lost trust in someone or something, those in the room or watching online that are learning what it means to walk in step with Jesus, and I also know there are those watching online or in the room that are still trying to figure out what Christianity's all about, and I hope today you find hope for your soul. I know I did in my study this week. And so let's read this passage together, Jeremiah 17, 5 through 10. Thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart turns away from the Lord. He's like a shrub in the desert and shall not see any good come. He shall dwell in the parched places of the wilderness, in an uninhabited salt land. But blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. He's like a tree planted by water that sends out its roots by the stream and does not fear when heat comes, for its leaves remain green, and is not anxious in the year of drought, for it does not cease to bear fruit. You see, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick. Who can understand it? But I, the Lord, search the heart and I test the mind to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his deeds. Let me pray for us this morning. God, we thank you for being the same God that was and is now and will be to come. And God, I pray for every story, every person that's watching online or in the room today, God, that you would give hope to the soul, that in the seasons of heat and pressure or drought and famine and struggle, God, those who trust in the Lord will continue to see the fruit of kingdom work and the work of the Spirit in our lives. God, I pray that today is hopeful and healing for our souls. And I pray all these things in Jesus' name, amen. So the start of this passage, Jeremiah, he really pulls no punches here. He gets right away to saying, thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength. And I think about that as those who rely on self, those who trust in self-reliance, My wife, Ritasha, and I just recently bought a new house, and this house we bought is pretty old. It was built in 1910, so it's got a lot of charm and a lot of quirks to it, and it definitely needed some updating for sure. And one of the things when we first moved into the house that we knew we wanted to get done was to update all of the flooring. When we walked into the house, there would be this old, dingy, like super worn down carpet into like the super dated laminate, into linoleum. It's like, what? Pick a floor, okay? Is how we felt in here. And so we're like, you know what? We just need to like tear everything up and put in one new flooring. And so I'm very thankful too that we had our families in town for when we pulled up all the flooring, because let me tell you, I think Ritasha and I, we would have pulled the flooring up and just sat there standing, just staring at this thing, oh no. Like, what are we doing? But thank goodness we had my dad and Ritasha's dad there that are pretty handy, and they were able to help us out. But anyway, we got the, like, tongue and groove click-in flooring, all right? So, super simple, all right? We didn't want to do all this crazy work. And so we got this tongue and groove flooring that clicks in, and on the box it says, like, it's super fast, it's super easy. I don't know who they're assuming is putting the floor together. But it's not Zach. It's not Zach. I'm telling you, I have never been so frustrated in my life. All right? We must have had to put down and pick up and put down and pick up the floor like 5 or 6 times. We had to start over and over and over again. Because the thing with this click-in flooring is that if you don't get it perfect in the first one, then you find out in like the 4th row, oh, wait, I think we messed up. And it all comes up again. And so I just feel like there are these moments where Ritasha and I are just putting together this flooring and we're just looking at each other and we're like, hey, I need you to remember, I love you. But I am very mad right now. And so we're putting together this flooring like last weekend. And so March Madness games are going on. So we got the basketball games on. We're putting the flooring together. And I'm getting to the point, you know that moment where like you're so mad you have to get up and like you're like so tense. Like I just can't. And I'm like, okay. And Ritasha's like, Zach, you need to settle down. All right, why don't you go? All right, my beloved Kentucky Wildcats were playing. She's like, just go watch the game. I'll handle the floor. You go watch the game. So I'm like, okay. I'm going to go take a break. I'm going to watch my Kentucky Wildcats, watch them play basketball, be fine. It was not fine. Because not only am I over here failing at what I assume should be a simple task, but I go over and watch my Kentucky Wildcats failing at what it means to be a basketball team. And I'm like, this is not helping. And all to say, I am with God on this one. Cursed is the man who trusts in man and trusts in Kentucky's man-to-man defense and makes flesh his strength. I agree. I'm with God on this one. You see, the Israelite people, God's chosen people, they'd now turned their attention to the strength and the ways of man. Now, all of a sudden, they're worshiping man-made idols and they're trusting them for provision. And they're turning to themselves saying, we can do this ourselves. We can protect ourselves. And here's the God that's led them out of Egypt, all right, into the promised land, led them every step of the way, and now only to abandon that God to the ways and the strength of man. And I have to check myself when I'm reading scripture, because sometimes I look at this, I'm like, how in the world could they do this? They were so closely connected to the many displays of the power of God and the provision of God. But the thing is, this wasn't all of a sudden, boom. You know what? Today, I'm not choosing God, I'm choosing man. This was a slow drift towards self and away from God. Hey, you know what? Those nations have a king. I wonder if we would have one. Or, you know what? Maybe I'll skip my morning temple time today. Or maybe, you know what? All those God parties, they're playing all the best music. Maybe I'll just go check that one out. It's a subtle drift. And so I have to check myself and ask, are there moments where you or myself are slowly drifting away from God towards the strength of man? We look at the world and we say, hey, the world has this or promotes this. What if I maybe had that? Or, you know what? I'm busy today. I got to get to work. Maybe I'll skip the morning Devo time today. I've just got too much on my plate. And then all of a sudden, we wake up and we see, man, I haven't prayed before bed. I haven't read my Bible. I haven't done a retreat in a while. Jeremiah shares that those that put all of their eggs in the man basket, that rely on themselves or the world of man, they're like shrubs in a desert. No good will come, he says. They'll dwell in parched places of the wilderness. And he talks about being in an uninhabited salt land. And this would have been referring mainly to the land around the Dead Sea. The Dead Sea, this salt water lake, and all around it, the salt would have gotten the soil. So there would have been nothing living around the Dead Sea. And so the strength of man, my own will only lead to places where I can't flourish. I can't find the right sustenance. And so why do we so easily maybe drift away from God and go towards human strength? Why do I maybe rely on myself or the world instead of God when I know who God is? Well, I think there's a reason why Jeremiah connects this with the heart of man. If you look at verse 5 at the end, it says, those whose hearts turn away from the Lord. Or if you go further to verse 9, he says that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick. And heart, we would assume when we talk about heart today, we're talking mainly about emotions. You think mind, you think thought, you think heart, you think emotions. Well, back during these times when Jeremiah was talking, heart didn't necessarily mean emotions. Heart meant like yourself, your nature, your innermost being. That's your heart. And he's saying the heart's deceitful. The heart goes towards things that aren't good, that aren't going to bring sustenance. Jesus says this in Mark chapter 7. He said, what comes out of a person is what defiles him. For from within, out of the heart of man, come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these things come from within, and they defile a person. The Lord is speaking through Jeremiah saying, your heart, your nature is sinful. If you put your trust in self, if you put your trust in your flesh, if you're the one to trust your heart with, your inner being, then this is the things you get. This is the fruit. And if this is the fruit, then yeah, you're gonna be like a shrub in the desert who's gonna see nothing good come because none of this that comes from the heart is good. This isn't good. This isn't filling. And so the Lord is prophesying, if you put your trust in man, if you put your trust in yourself, if you put your trust in the world, the fruit will be nothing good. It's gonna be parched. It's gonna need so much more. And here's the thing, you don't need to be a botanist to know that plants need nutrients or that plant is not surviving. And maybe you do have to be a botanist to know that salt does kill plants. If I have a plant and I water it with salt water, it's gonna kill the plant. The thing is, if you want good fruit, then your heart can't be entrusted to me to say, I'll fix it, I'll handle it. My heart has to be entrusted to the Lord. I can't trust another person. I can't trust my own strength to take care of my inner self. The deepest parts of my soul, I cannot trust myself with. The strength and the heart of man is not something we can rely on. They are something we must rely on God with. The strength in the heart of man is not something we can rely on. They are something we must rely on God with. And I found this. I found this in my own personal life, that I do not have the strength to overcome the hardest parts of my life. I may be able to say I do, but in reality, I don't. Nor I know I cannot take care of my own heart when it's the most broken. I've tried, and I can't. And I want to read verse 9 and a little part of 10, which is why I think it's so important of how we trust in the Lord, right? Verse 9 says, the heart is deceitful above all things. It's desperately sick. Who can understand it? But then it says, I, the Lord, search the heart and I test the mind. Who better to take care of my heart, my inner self, than the only one that understands it? God understands my heart. He understands the deepest, most inner parts of myself, which is why I'm learning in my own spiritual formation that I have to daily entrust the Lord with all of my heart and all of my strengths. Which is why I think it's no coincidence that when Jesus talks about the greatest commandment, it is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and with all your strength. Church, if we're to be a tree here in Jeremiah that's planted by a stream that does not wither or cease to bear good fruit, we cannot live on the life and strength of man. I've got to give it to God. Or in other words, I can't live on the life and strength of man. I have to die to it. I believe this wholeheartedly. In order to trust the Lord, to not rely on man, it means to die to myself, actually. Matthew 10, 38 through 39, it says, "Whoever does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life," or whoever tries to fix his life, who tries to rely on his own strength, is going to lose it. "But whoever loses his life, whoever dies to himself, whoever entrusts God with everything for my sake will find it." To trust in the Lord means to die to self, to let God take control. And so we look at this. We look at what does it look like to trust in the Lord? Who are those that trust in the Lord? Verse 7 and verse 8. "Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. He's like a tree planted by water." This passage actually parallels to the start of Psalm chapter 1. The very beginning of Psalms says this: "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And on his law he meditates day and night. He's like a tree planted by streams of water, that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers." Scripture says that those who trust in the Lord, or those that take delight in the Lord, or those that daily attach themselves to him, are like a tree planted right next to a stream of water. And without fail, that tree will continue to bear fruit in its season. I know a lot of us in the room, maybe watching online, we live in Illinois. We see a lot of flat. We see a lot of flat, we see a lot of farmland. But I remember when I was little, as we would drive the interstates of Illinois, all right, I-39, most boring drive maybe ever, all right? And I remember you'd drive and you'd see for miles and miles, it'd be flat and be farm. But then all of a sudden you'd see this line of trees. And I remember I'd ask my parents, I'd be like, what's going on with those trees? And they would tell me, they'd be like, "There's probably some water over there." And now, even as an adult, I drive the interstates of Illinois and I see lines of trees in the midst of flats. And every time, there's a stream right there. And I think about the Great Lake Bloomington. And it took me a while to realize, why in the world are all these trees just in this one pocket here? And it's because there's a giant body of water right there. What does it look like to trust in the Lord? It looks like setting up shop right next to water. Setting up shop right next to water. And let me tell you, would you just look at the conversation that Jesus has with the Samaritan woman in John chapter 4? A woman from Samaria came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. And the Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you actually would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us this well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." And Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give will never be thirsty again." In the midst of the heat, in the midst of the drought, if I want my life to be fruitful, if I want my life to be full of hope, I have to root myself in Jesus. If Jesus is who he says he is, if Jesus says, I am this living water that makes me never thirsty again, never thirsty for anything else to fill the most broken parts of myself, then you know what? I'm setting up shop in Jesus and I'm not leaving. And I'm letting Jesus fill me. My strength now is gonna be Jesus's. My heart, Jesus, you can have this. Because if you have living water that says I will never yearn for something more, then I'm setting up shop in you. Because I don't know about you all, but in the seasons of the most intense heat, the most intense pressure, or the seasons of serious drought, if there is a promise and a hope that the fruit of my life will never stop, then I'm clinging to that promise. I'm clinging to it. Jesus says this in John chapter 7, whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Again, now all of a sudden my heart, out of my heart is not flowing all of the things of self. It's now flowing rivers of living water. But here, Jesus doesn't stop. He now is connecting us now to the Spirit. And he says, now this he said about the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were to receive, for as yet the Spirit had not been given because Jesus was not yet glorified. I want you to notice here that how the Holy Spirit now comes into play. That this living water that Jesus is talking about, the idea that Jesus is speaking is that a tree by the stream, because of this rootedness in Jesus, because of this connectedness to Jesus, now means an outpouring of the Spirit. So what's cool here is that we flip the script when we change our trust from flesh to trust in the Spirit. The fruit becomes drastically different. It's very different fruit when we say, I'm not gonna trust in man, I'm not gonna trust in self anymore, I'm not gonna trust myself to pick myself up by the bootstraps and get through this, I'm gonna fully entrust myself to the Spirit, the fruit becomes drastically different. Galatians says this, for the desires of the flesh, or the fruit from the flesh, or the things from the heart, are totally against the Spirit. And the desires of the Spirit are totally against the flesh, for these are opposed to each other, to keep you from doing the things you want to do. Meaning, trust in the flesh, trust in the heart of man, or in my own strength, it's gonna keep me from reaping the fruit that I really want to reap. But if you trust in the Spirit, we reap this kind of fruit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things, there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus, those who set up shop in Jesus, have crucified now the flesh. With all of the passions and desires, we die to the self. And if we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. Church, this is the fruit I want. This is the fruit I need in the seasons of heat and drought and struggle. And I would assume this is the fruit that all of us want to bear. To be like a tree that's planted by water that doesn't fear when heat comes or isn't anxious in the year of drought, that does not fear when money is tight or the pressure of work is greater or the tension in my marriage is higher or the diagnosis I get is not what I wanted to hear. But instead, the fruit of my life says that I'm at peace when money is tight, that I'm loving and gentle in my marriage, that I'm joyful in the hard realities. Or we think about this and we say, I'm not anxious in the year of spiritual drought or singleness or the terrible twos, right? But instead, I'm faithful in spiritual drought. I'm patient in singleness. I'm self-controlled with my toddlers. Even in the most hopeless seasons, to have leaves that remain green and fruit that doesn't cease, to have this fruit of the Spirit, I want that. I want this for my life in the hardest parts. But how do we do that? How do I get this kind of fruit? And church, I believe this with all of my heart, The Lord has been preaching this to me over and over and over again in this season, that our call as Christ followers is to take root in Jesus, to abide in him, or, as the NLT says, to remain. To remain in Jesus. Remain in him when things get hard. Remain in the drought. Remain in the heat. Remain, remain, remain. Don't leave him. Which is why the Spirit led me to John 15 this week, to really anchor our passage this morning alongside Jeremiah 17, to think about us being those that remain in the vine. John 15, 4 through 11, 5 through 11, 4 through 11 says, "Remain in me, and I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit if it's severed from the vine. And I cannot be fruitful. I cannot bear the fruit of the Spirit, bear these things that I want, unless I remain in Jesus. Yes, I am the vine and you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them, they will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. You're like a shrub in the desert. Anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile to be burned. But if you remain in me, and my words remain in you, you may ask for anything you want, and it will be granted. When you produce much fruit, you are my disciples. This brings great glory to the Father. And I have loved you, even as the Father has loved me, and so remain in my love. When you obey my commandments, you remain in my love, just as I obey my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you these things so that you will be filled with joy. Yes, your joy will overflow." Church, when all else might be crumbling, when my life is shaken, when my trust in the heart and the strength of man proves futile, remain. Remain, remain, remain. When we have a hope that remains in the Lord, the heat and the drought can come, but they cannot stop the fruit. When I have a hope that stays connected to the vine, that plants itself right next to water and remains daily, the fruit will not stop. The fruit of God's kingdom work will continue to happen. When I have a hope that remains in the Lord in the midst of my personal heat and drought, the living God in me, the Holy Spirit, will not stop bearing the fruit of his kingdom. He will not stop doing a good work in me. He will not stop redeeming me and washing me clean by the power of his blood, who from him springs forth living water, so that no one will thirst for anything ever again. Amen. 1 John 4:13 says this, "By this we know, we abide, we remain in him and he in us, because he's given us his Spirit." When we remain in the Lord, the Spirit comes and does the work and bears the fruit. 1 John 4:16 through 18 says, "So we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is love. And whoever abides in love then abides in God, and God abides in him. By this is love perfected with us, so that we may have confidence for the day of judgment. Because as he is, so also are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear." That's why I can read this passage and I can see Jesus continuing to share this, that, oh, I don't have to be afraid of the heat. I don't have to be anxious in the seasons of drought, because when I abide, when I root, when I plant myself next to living water, I will continue to bear the fruit. I will continue to have the hope that God's grace is continuing to do a work in me. Church, there's so much interconnectedness with our attachment and our trust in God to the work of the Spirit in our lives. So much connectedness that if you remain in God, the Spirit will do his work. And I have found this. In this season of my life, You know, people have come up and asked me, how are you doing? How are you processing? How are you handling? And you know what I say? I just say over and over, I just want to be faithful. I just want to be faithful. But here's the thing with faithfulness that I've realized in the study of the passage this week and in rooting myself in John chapter 15. I realized that the fruit of faithfulness comes with more minutes with Jesus than more minutes on a stage. And I found that more joy comes from more worship of the King than more worship of a paycheck. And more peace comes from more cooperation with the Spirit than more cooperation with a schedule. And more love comes from more communion with the Father than more communion with a piece of technology. I have to root myself in Jesus to get this fruit, to have this kind of hope. Nothing else comes. I will thirst for nothing more if I root myself in Jesus. But again, I'm not naive to know that this kind of hope, it takes time. It comes from a deep personal relationship with the Creator, which is why one of the most famous hope passages comes in the same vein as patient endurance. And Tommy being with us, he's talked about this verse a couple times. But Romans 5, 3 through 5 says, we rejoice in our sufferings. We rejoice in the heat and the drought and the struggle, knowing that our suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Do you see all of this connectedness? The fruit of the Spirit, the heart, the strength of man and God. It's so connected. It all comes back to entrusting God with every single part of me. Dying to self and letting God take control because I can't do this myself. Hope comes from entrusting our hearts to God, letting his love pour into it, and then the Holy Spirit, do the rest. Remain. Don't detach from the vine. If anything, get deeper. A lot of these passages we've been talking about, we've talked a lot about plants, so I thought I'd wrap up with another plant. As I was preparing this week, one of our coworkers, Rick, he came up to me and he's like, hey, I heard about the passage you're preaching. Have you heard about the bamboo tree? And I'm like, no, I haven't. And he told me about this and he's like, you might want to look it up to make sure it's true. And so I did, and it's true. The Chinese bamboo tree does not start shooting up out of the ground until like year 4 or 5 after it's planted. And so a farmer can water, a farmer can take care of this and won't see any growth for like 4 years. But the thing is, it's not that that tree's not growing. It's growing down. It's growing down deep and it's building an elaborate root system so that in year 4, year 5, that bamboo tree takes off. Let me tell you this, these trees can grow 3 feet in a day. All right, that's a little less than half of me, okay? 3 feet in a day. In 6 weeks, a bamboo tree can grow to 90 feet tall. That's not possible without first spending time growing deep. Hope looks like patient endurance. It looks like remaining in the vine when things are difficult and when things are good. It's saying when my life gets hard, when my life is crumbling, when my heart is broken, I just get deeper. I don't detach from the vine. I actually put all of my trust in it. All of my eggs get out of the man basket and into the God basket. And I put all of my trust in it so that in its season, the fruit will explode in a glorious fury of God's grace and work in my life. And so in the midst of the heat and the drought, church, I hope this for you. I know this for me. My hope will remain in Jesus because nothing can stop the fruit. Amen.
When all around me collapses and falls, and hope wanes within me and troubles my soul, I know the one who breaks every wall. Jesus, you answer my every call. Some trust in ways of men, some trust in their own plans, but I trust the name of Jesus. May the Lord grant you his peace from the strife. May he remember and he hear every cry. May he protect you in darkest of night. The morning will come and his word be your light. Some trust in ways of men, and some trust in their own plans, but I trust the name.
You can go ahead and have a seat. We We just sang together, we trust in the name of Jesus Christ and we trust in his ways. And I have to believe for the majority of us in here today, that's true. But sometimes we just need to be reminded of that because it feels good in this moment. We acknowledge we trust in his name and his ways. And then we go out those doors and life hits us right between the eyes over and over and over. And so it's good to be together to remember that. One of my favorite trust passages in the New Testament is actually Mark chapter 9. It's something a dad says in desperation. He is desperate for his kid who's in a bad spot. And as an act of faith, this dad, he brings his son to the disciples for healing, and the disciples try to heal the kid, and they fail. And so the disciples, with their tails between their legs, they take the boy and the dad and they go see Jesus. And in a moment of brutal honesty, the dad says, if you can heal my son. I have to believe Jesus in that gracious moment with a smile on his face. He says, if I can heal him. And the dad says, I know, I believe, help my unbelief. And I wonder how many of us can resonate with that. We do trust and we do believe, but there are moments in our life where we say, Jesus, I believe. Can you just help my unbelief? And here's the good news. God's shoulders are pretty broad. He can carry that tension. When we say we believe and we trust, but help my unbelief, we're taking that to God and he can handle it. And in 2 weeks, we're celebrating Easter. It's a moment in our calendar as Christ followers where we remember that Jesus goes into the dark places and he brings life. He goes into the dead places, the crucifixion of the cross, the darkness of the tomb, and then he walks out bringing life and resurrection. And we want to invite you into a special moment this Easter Sunday. We want to invite you to have some space now to think about a space in your life that feels dead, that feels dark, maybe a place where you're tempted to say, God, I believe you can do something here, but can you just help my unbelief? And so here's what we want to do. If you're willing, in the quiet, I'd love for everybody to grab your phone. Go ahead and grab it right now. And behind me on the screen, you're going to see a number that you can text. This isn't our text hello. We're asking you to take 30 seconds and reflect on the spaces in your life that feel dark, that feel dead, that are in the tomb, that you're asking Jesus to bring healing and light and resurrection to. And if you're willing, would you text hope, then a dash, and whatever that is. Maybe it's your marriage. Maybe there's a relationship that's estranged and feels dead. Maybe it's finances. Maybe it's a whole host of things that Zach already talked about. I don't need to repeat those things. But we want to celebrate on Easter those areas in our life that feel dead, that feel dark. We want to acknowledge them and ask Jesus to help us in our unbelief. And so in the next 15, 20 seconds, if there's an area in your life that you resonate with, would you text it to that number behind us? And in a few moments, I'll pray. God, we want to be trees that are planted by streams of water, that no matter what we're going through personally, we produce fruit, we have hope, we have peace that's found in you. And we know there are areas of our life, Jesus, that we need to give to you. We're asking for resurrection. We're asking for fruit, for life out of death. And we text those to you. We give them to you. We ask that you would do a mighty work in Jesus' name. Amen. If you weren't ready or didn't have something that came to your mind, you can always text throughout this week leading up to Easter those things that God that have in your life that you need healing. Before we head out today, though, I want to share a few things as we head out midweek just to remember. The first is if you're visiting today and you're new to Eastview, we would love to get to know you. You can text hello at any point throughout the week in our service to the number behind me, and we would love to connect with you. And if you're here at the Normal campus, we'd love to meet you face-to-face in the family room after the service. It's out in the lower level of the atrium. So if you're new and you're ready to connect, you have a question, you have a prayer request, we would love to get to know you and put a name and a face together. We also want to encourage you, obviously Easter is in 2 weeks, so there's two dates to remember. We have a Good Friday service on Friday, March 7th. That's going to be at 7 p.m. here at the Normal campus, and we're going to sit in the pain of the crucifixion and Jesus being in the tomb, and then we're going to celebrate on Easter Sunday with three different services, 8 o'clock, 9:45, and 11:30. Our kids' programming will be available at all three services, but we have a special student service combined for our junior high and our high school students at the 11:30. So if you're used to coming together as a family on Easter, by all means, please do that. But if your students are excited for their own service, that'll be at the 11:30 service. And then finally, you've probably seen the kiosks out in the atrium. They got flowers and balloons to draw attention to those, but there are different cards and invitations and stickers and things to make invitations to Easter. And I know I'm going over right now, but I don't care. I just have to be honest. I have not felt like inviting my people the last several weeks. I've got my card. I love McLean County still. We're not shying away from this. In fact, we're going to talk more about our vision next week. But it's been a struggle for me to reach out to my people over the last month. And I just felt like God has laid on my heart, it's not about you, it's about me. And God is still beautiful. And God is still gracious and kind and loving. And he said, it's not about you, Tyler, it's about them. That I died for them so that they could know me and have a relationship with me. And so I just need to get out of the way, no matter how I feel. And so the most beautiful thing that could happen today is all the invitation materials that we have out in the atrium, they're just gone because we've grabbed them and made those invitations. So can I just encourage you, your people with Love McLean County, it may feel like a weird time to make an invitation, but God is still who he says he is. And there are people in our community who are lost and they're hurting and they're bottoming out this week. And we have a message of hope. So those invitation materials are still out there. We can still love McLean County in this season. And then finally, just a reminder to catch up on all things Eastview, go to eastview.church/enews. You can learn more about our midweek devos and student activities, kids stuff there. And so we're so thankful that you guys are here today. As you go out today, God bless you. May we be the hands and feet of Jesus to this community. You're dismissed.